With the success of The Invisible Man and the resurgence of the original Universal Monsters, I wanted to remind everyone of one of the best interpretations of a classic horror icon, the 2013 Dracula series that was on NBC. Along this wave of Universal Monster love, there's also been an upswing in Dracula content, like the Klaus Bangs-led BBC, Netflix production, and the recent news we'd be getting a series focused on Dracula's brides, among others, in the pipeline, which ironically just cast Goran Vyshnyk as Dracula. Having just recently played Nikolai Tesla in Doctor Who, you'll see the irony in a second. The 2013 series was fantastic, and came along around the time that NBC was producing another anti-hero-led series, Hannibal. But Dracula wouldn't be as lucky as Hannibal. Hannibal managed to get at least 3 seasons from the network, where Dracula got one run of 10 episodes. And of course, it ended on a cliffhanger. But before that, we got some beautiful and bloody stuff from the show, which came from the minds behind far more civilized fare, such as Downton Abbey. This version of Dracula would show a slightly young Van Helsing as a revenge seeker, using Dracula as a tool against a group known as the Order of the Dragon. Dracula was also betrayed by them, and as such, Van Helsing would see him as the perfect ally and weapon. Van Helsing commits murder in the first 5 minutes of the show to awaken Dracula from his slumber, so right away you know this show is different. Creator Cole Haddon and Daniel Knopf take the original source material and shape it into something unique and fresh. There's more than a little bit of steampunk here, as Dracula is molded into a Tesla-like character, even down to the facial hair, who is using science to take on the Order of the Dragon, which is made up of oil barons. The story speaks to the current environment, which is trying to stop these same type of villains today. And while they may seem an odd tactic for Dracula to take, he's right. That's the way you hurt them. It's also interesting to see this mythic creature using science and industry to take on his enemies. But Dracula was a tactician, and even in the book he is thorough and learns ways to use money and the law to get his way. This new take on Dracula also takes a look at feminism and racism. Here, Renfield isn't a madman who eats bugs. He's a very erudite and cultured black man who works for Dracula of his free will, and the two mutually respect one another. One of the most ferocious vampire hunters in the show is Lady Jane, who is the equal of any of the men and better than most. She's rich, independent, and is not restrained in her sexual desires at all. She's also a complete badass. Mina is not yet married to Jonathan Harker and wants to be a doctor in a time that was rare. She's actually a student of Professor Van Helsing's, and Dracula supports her in her goals. This does cause some issues with her relationship with John Harker, though, who here is now not a law clerk, but a reporter, which allows a lot of juicy storytelling to come into play. Lucy Westrena, it turns out, is actually in love with Mina, so we see that yes, there were in fact lesbians back in the 1800s. The show also shows us the secret gay gentlemen's club of the time and the outright hypocrisy of the men who would shame homosexuals while secretly being gay. This is not your parents' Dracula, and is simply fantastic. NBC's Dracula, as I said, had more than a little bit of steampunk aesthetic, but it also didn't hold back on the blood and the slick fight scenes with a bit of the old Matrix slow-mo thrown in. The series was gory, with lots of beheadings, brain smashing, and Dracula chomping and slicing his way through a number of victims. Jonathan Rhys Meyers was awesome as Dracula. He brought a sinister, gentlemanly devil air to the character, while also employing that Christopher Lee type of brutal beast mentality when it clicked in. He also brought the sympathetic nature of Dracula to the part as well, showing a deep and abiding love for Mina, as the series would play with the reincarnated love-lost trope and make it work out for Dracula for once. For once, Dracula got the girl. Thomas Ketchum as Van Helsing was a great choice too. He could hold his own against Dracula and would actually play Dracula in the Dario Argento flick Dracula 3D around the time this series aired. You soon found out that Van Helsing is actually more bloodthirsty than Dracula. He doesn't shy away from getting his hands bloody. Oliver Jackson Cohen, who is now his own monster as the Invisible Man, played Jonathan Harker, and he was great in the role, which showed Harker as a man trapped between what was expected of him at the time, his pride, and being in love with a woman that didn't fit the norm. Jessica DeGuy as Mina is also fantastic. Following along the lines of the Frank Langella-led Dracula from 1979, DeGuy's Mina refuses to play by the rules of society and dreams of becoming more than what is expected of her. Where Jonathan plays along, Dracula shows support of her goals and pride when she succeeds. She's a vision in the costumes they've chosen for her too, which is really shows a purity within a dark and dangerous world. They really, really stand out. Of course, he does come around, but being Jonathan Harker, he ends up screwing that up as well. So, yeah. Victoria Smurfette is amazing as Lady Jane. Created for the series, Lady Jane is just breathtaking in the costumes they've created for her, and goddamn fearless as a vampire hunter. Smurfette just rules in this part and holds her own against all of the men in the Order of the Dragon, as well as Dracula. She is a worthy opponent. Katie McGrath as Lucy brings an interesting mix of sadness, ego, and fragility to Lucy. Her story isn't a happy one, but you can't help but blame her for her own misery a little bit. Things don't go well for Lucy. Rounding out the cast is Nonzo Anozie as Renfield. Coming off a brief but entertaining run on Game of Thrones, Anozie makes a great choice in this role. Dracula seems to find kindred souls in the outcasts, and his Renfield is one that wouldn't be accepted by the very white upper crust of society. He's snarky, and it's fun to watch him call out his employer's BS. NBC's Dracula deserved far better than what it was given. Sadly, I expected network TV wouldn't be a long-lived home for the series, and I was sadly right. But the 10 episodes we did get are truly epic, and the final episode sets up what could have been a phenomenal second season, with a new threat for Dracula and all sorts of new plots to be followed. What could have been will always haunt us, but I'm very thankful for what we got, which is an awesome entry into the Dracula history. You can purchase the series, if you can find it, on DVD and Blu-ray. Also, you can buy the entire series on Vudu. I strongly suggest you do so because any vampire, Dracula, or horror fan will find something to love here.